traditional auto dealership business is increasingly becoming less popular among young entrepreneurs. The next generation is more keen on taking up business which offers higher return on less investment. The automobile industry is becoming capital intensive and the growth is also very slow. This panel discussion will explore the reasons to why should Generation Next take up this business. To discuss and find out the answers, let us call on stage our eminent speakers. Can we request our esteemed panelists to please step on stage? Let's please welcome each of them with a big round of applause. Mr. Shaunak Parekh, Director, Utkal Automobiles. Mr. Rajneesh Agarwal, Director, BR Group. Mr. Puneet Barwani, Director, GK Group. Mr. Amit Ghai, Director, Amit Motors Private Limited. And may we also request Mr. Vinkesh Gulati, Partner, United Automobiles, to kindly join us on stage and moderate this session.
Hi, everybody. The topic has already informed to you it's why the next gen is shying away. So I have two people who are speaking for and two against. Obviously, it's a mixed bag. We all know, I've seen some where topic discussed on what is this actually. So I saw it like in 1984, the teenagers born after 1984 are called millennials. And they are born when everything has instant things happening. They are not able to wait for the long run effect, and their basic working is morely on the short term plans, short term gains, and they grow up in a world of instant gratification, whereas as per our auto trade, it's a long run break even session. So let's discuss on this millennials. And to start with, I'll request, Shaunak, you want to start?
So good evening, everyone. So any automobile dealership today requires a lot of capital commitment. An automobile dealership, whether you're managing a new one, managing an existing one or setting up a new one, is always a high cost, high capital intensive affair. Whether you're partnering with a multinational or an Indian manufacturer, the cost of investment, the size of investment is most likely the same. Then we also have the cost of infrastructure is the highest. The cost of inventory being the second highest. Cost of inventory of cars, of spare parts is another key factor as far as capital commitment is concerned. So most of the brands have a policy, a pen down policy actually, that you have to have anywhere between 21 days to 30 days inventory at your dealership. But the ground reality is very different. Most of us carry at least beyond 40 days worth of inventory. The third point which I would like to make is the cost of manpower, of course, is also very high. And all this put together leads to a lot of high debt, a lot of high borrowings from the bank. And as somebody rightly put it today, that at the end of the day, the banks make more money than the auto dealerships. So finally, with also every new product launch, your manufacturer keeps asking for maybe for you to upkeep your infrastructure or to add new infrastructure. So again, you're putting in more investments. So basically, your fixed investments are always increasing, and that's why I feel, you know, the capital commitment into the automobile dealership is really high.
Puneet, will you want to say something on this?
Yeah, I'd like to add on. I'm also a second generation into my business, into automobile business, and I firmly believe that next gen should be the part of auto dealership. The main thing what I see is, India is the fastest growing market for the automobile in the world. At presently, we are doing around 3 million cars. It would be expected to be around 5 to 6 million by 2020. So next gen should be part of the sector which is growing in this speed. And again, as Shaunak said, that is very capital intensive. I do agree that it is very capital intensive business. But what I believe that if our funds involved in the business can be rotated 8 to 9 times in a year, we can earn reasonable amount of profits. And we have seen ample examples today throughout the day. Popular Service is a very prime example. They are managing the business professionally and they have expanded it to a scale, employing around 7,000 people. Then Sai Point, we just saw him, they are selling around 60,000 vehicles. So what I feel that NextGen should be part of the auto dealership business, because this is the way forward and India is bound to become one of the biggest market for automobile in the world.
Wow, Puneet. Really, a dealer to becoming a bank, we just saw what has happened. So every NextGen should be there. So let's hear from Rajneesh what you want to say on this.
Well, I'm a second generation dealer in Lucknow. I just want to say that I agree with Shaunak that the automotive sales will move up. There's a good future in automotive retail. However, I feel that the current way of how the model is structured is not favorable for my next gen. If you ask me, do you want my children to be in the business? And I possibly would have to think twice, because the risk versus reward ratio for a businessman in this business is very, very poor. You have systemic risks. The previous speaker talked about the government policies being changed. Companies going out of favor. So there are lots of risks outside your control, and also risks within your control, but they are risks nevertheless. The reward that you get out from the business, less than a 1% margin, net margin, less than 2% gross margins, just don't reward enough for the risk that we are taking. That's one. Second thing, I think the competitive pressure on the market is not allowing for a good representation of the dealers with the OEMs. OEMs are very, very powerful. They have a lot of investments. They own the product. They own the brand. They own the pricing. And the dealers are unable to, I would say, take out value in the relationship. So as a result, they're not able to get the money out of the business. And third, I would say, my third point is, for any of my next gen to be in the business, they want emotional satisfaction, emotional security, and the business is quite stressful, and I'm not so sure that we get the emotional security and the emotional satisfaction from being in the business. That's why I think the next gen may be shying away from the business, and I definitely want my children to be in the business. Continuing ahead.
So, I don't know. Good points, but let's see what Amit wants to say on this.
So, Venkesh, I run my dealership in a tier 3 town, so I have a very different perspective. So, one for me would be what opportunities are available there for the next generation in terms of doing business. So, setting up an industry is very difficult with so many government regulations, laws of the land, availability of raw materials, then the end product needs to go somewhere else. So an automobile dealership again gives you that scale of a big turnover adding on to an existing business which one would be doing. So for I would expect my generation, next generation to come on board and probably take it to the next level. There are no decent opportunities available. So, and taking up an automobile dealership immediately adds turnovers of 50 crores, 100 crores. We have been seeing since morning groups which are already doing 1,000 crores worth of business in a financial year and talking about doubling it in the coming 5 to 10 years. So that's the story I'll go back and share with my next generation. You see, the scales are available, the opportunities are available, the difficulties which we have been hearing about the cost of acquisition of land is much lower in a smaller town. All the manufacturers, the new or the old one, are expanding, moving further inwards, further away from the urban towns. So that's where opportunity becomes available for a tier 2 or a tier 3 town dealer. the biggest benefit I see for the second generation on why they should be a part of this function, this business, it is a very structured business. So what all effort needs to be taken would be probably in establishing the infrastructure and hiring the manpower. Everything else becomes a defined process which your team just needs to carry forward. And the dealerships now, it's becoming a very corporate kind of a job. So even we as dealer principals are not expected to be present at the dealership 24/7. We have different technology tools wherein from remote locations, we can monitor and ensure that the systems are running as they're supposed to be running. The process is followed. We hire professionals to run business for us. We just act as mentors to them, share our visions, ensure that we are on the same page, our team and us are on the same page as our principals. So I think it's a very well-defined, if we get that industry status somewhere down the line, it's a very defined industry to be in. It's a very well-documented, well-processed, and there are ample success stories which we've been seeing since morning here. So I, per se, been in the industry, being a second-gen dealer myself into the dealership for the last 17 years, I have changed, evolved with the way the industry has changed and evolved, and I am still ready to adapt to whatever changes or the threats or the perceptions we have as dealer principals. So,
well said, Amit. To second that, I feel the next gen normally works for, they want to give an impact to the whatever they do. And one name which comes, everybody must have seen last time, Naveen Saraogi was there, who represented. He is also a next gen dealer. And Shaunak, you are also a next gen dealer and still you are opposing it. How so? What's?
I think the first point we made, that, you know, the commitment level, not just capital in terms of even your time commitment levels, or is too high in this industry. And most of all, you know, there are a lot of influences, there are a lot of factors which influence the industry which are beyond your control. Like, we've all been through this BS3, BS4, and just recently the GST. So all these are issues which hamper our business, and especially the BS3, BS4 transition, given the short time period that we had of 72 hours to really sell out all the stock. So again, it's high risk and low returns, and that's why I feel, you know, it just does not really carry forward. Maybe the third generation won't be here at FADA for me.
So can I ask any of you to at least next generation comes in?
I'd just like to add on a very important perspective to what I've already shared. So again, coming back to from where I come from, a tier 2 or tier 3 town, it's a big business. It's a seat of respect and recognition. Plus, the kind of acceptance you get, the kind of recognition you get by contributing to the social development of that area. So see, all of us have been talking about turnovers and the number of employees. So in a tier 2, tier 3 town in your dealership, if you have 500, 600 people working for you, so you're in a way supporting 500, 600 families. The employment opportunity which we are presenting there, we are adding on to the economic development of that place. We won't ever get industries moving to smaller places. We'll never have that situation in India, I suppose, that people would be moving to smaller towns to set up industries, because setting up industries has a different kind of challenge. You need to be closer to the place where you source your raw material from, or you need to be closer to a port wherein you would want to ship your products from. So I take that as a very big reward for the next generation also. Millennials, they want everything fast, they want quick turnovers, plus they want a gratification. A social recognition that they're giving something back to the society. And we as dealers are already doing that. They probably can come on board with better new ideas and how to give back to the societies, empower people in our area. So that's my point of view.
So I agree with you, Amit. On this front in auto retail, we dealers are doing better than OEMs because OEMs set up a factory one, maybe in one place or two, and we are going to the length of rural and hiring them there. But still, somewhere we have to find out how, as an auto retail, we have a very good image. But once you talk of dealerships, there was a time 30 years back, people used to say, he's a dealer, so he has a lot of money. But that is not the same image we have today. He's a dealer, so he means he has a lot of debt. So what do you think, how to change the image back to the...
We may not have that kind of money with us, but we do have big palaces to showcase our products from. But on a more serious note, see to any industry, like being into an automobile dealerships, the multiple avenues or profit centers we have. So it is just not selling a new vehicle wherein we are earning money. We have insurance business. We have the after sales business which earns money for us. There are innumerable streams of revenue which would actually make up the profit in the balance sheet. So it again becomes a business which provides you a set off if the sales are not doing good and you have enough vehicles in the market, immediate sustenance doesn't become a challenge. So you can still service vehicles. Yes, of course, we need to stay lean always as dealerships, because as somebody senior in the industry once shared with me, it is an elephant. Running an automobile dealership is very similar to feeding an elephant. Jitna khilaoge, utna khata jayega. So we have to ensure that we feed the right amount of capital into it. And we to ensure that the expenses side are very well monitored, very well and professionally monitored.
So,
I just want to provide some rebuttal to my colleagues over here. They talked about scale, or you know, adding hundreds of crores of top line, or inventory turns. We talked about 9 or 10 times turning your inventories. My where I beg to differ is that with each inventory turn, each time you rotate the capital, it must leave something as a profit. If you just keep rotating the inventory without any profit for you, so it will not. I cannot fund my CSR activities. I cannot fund the giving back, because ultimately I need profit, and the profit is when it's too little or too less than the reward than the risk I'm taking on. It may not be sufficient to go over the down cycle, a policy change, a BS3 to BS4 conversion, or a GST, or some other systemic change. I need the capital to overcome those changes. So I just need that profit to survive the changes. And that's why I think next gen, it may be a difficult task for them. You talk about insurance business and other businesses. It's all operational. You can improve the efficiency by 1 or 2%, 2-3%, maybe 5%, 10% even. But strategically, the challenge, the structure of the industry is set up so that it's a very challenging industry for the next gen to come in. I think it'll take many, many years for them to get seasoned to it before they can accept it in its full form.
So Ranisha, so any discussion between dealers, I know, comes down to margins. So, but let's keep it up to the next gen. I know the margins is an issue, but still, there is a lot to our dealerships in overall. Puneet, you want to add something?
So. Yeah. I'll just add 2 things. Any business we do, it requires commitment, be it if you are in real estate or anything else. So, same is the case with the automobile. And I'll go to my first point. This is the industry where growth is happening. This is the industry where India will be one of the largest market in the world, and next gen cannot miss this bus just by thinking that it's a very capital intensive business or it's difficult to generate profit. We have to find out ways, and as an industry, as a dealership fraternity, we have to find out ways, collaborate with our OEMs to find out ways to make this venture profitable and run, because mobility will be there, automobile will be there in India. Thank you.
I will still reiterate and will like to not agree with what Rajneesh says. being into this business and still make it very attractive for the next generation to become a part of it, we just need to be eager to adapt. And we need to be aware of what's happening around us in terms of technology changes, government regulation changes. So all the industries are very competitive. There are challenges everywhere. If GST was a challenge for us, GST was a challenge for any other industry in the country. But we as Indians are very quick to adapt, very intelligent in finding out means, devising ways to get over crisis. So I am still very positive, and I go back home and talk to my son good things about the day at work, irrespective of how the day goes. So,
Shanak, you want to pitch in something on?
So, my point here was, you know, if you look at the Indian auto industry, then it's just the top three manufacturers who hold 80% of the market share. So if you're not with any of these three, for you to scale up or actually grow is almost close to impossible. So that's where the risk is there. And plus the fact is that with the three also, if you're one of partners with any of them, then the size of the investment that they command is also quite huge. And to get the returns back, is the ROI almost does not come before at least five to 6 or 7 years. So that's why I feel that the young generation who don't want, who don't have that horizon of like 6-7 years, would probably never look at the auto industry as in as a business, you know.
So don't you feel the way this auto industry has been for the past 40-50 years, the way our fathers or we are handling, if next gen comes and tries to do a different way of work, then OEMs start listening to the dealers and change their ways, or think of something other than just being a principal agent relationship than be a partnership relationship?
So all the entire brands that we have here, the entire process is very regulated. So it's already penned down. So you hardly have too much space for innovation. You know, so you really can't think out of the box. So I feel the next generation in that sense will probably feel really claustrophobic, because they can't really innovate much. They have to stick to the guidelines of the principal. They have to stick to the policies. So there's not too much room of innovation that anybody would, you know, really put their thinking hat on and do something about it.
You want to say something?
Yeah, can I do that? I do think that the OEMs will adapt, and I agree with Amit over here that as time goes by, the format or the model will change, and I do think that the OEMs will change with the industry, because as many of them have pointed out in the session, that the dealer, the channel is really, really important, and I do think that they have an open ear for changes. I just think that in the current format, it will not be possible. And we have to be very innovative, very forward-looking, try new ideas, and that's how I think the industry may evolve, and the next gen may come in the system and bring about these changes.
So let's summarize then. I feel anything more to add on? So I feel as an auto industry, as the dealer forum, as FADA, even as ET Auto, we have also to play a role to make the image of this industry grow. ET Auto is doing good thing by publishing some stories about the dealers, John, Dilip, by Sandeep Kher and all that. So automatically people will be enticed by going through all this matter. And no doubt automobile is one business which has to stay, because mobility is the important thing for future also. So let's hope that everybody put together makes this business as the most needed or wanted business to come in for the next gen. And we all should do something, so at least they, like you said, please ask your kids to join. It's a good business and it will be a good business. It has been for the past 40 years, it will be further. So thanks all four of you. It was real great. And I hope we'll have more discussions like that. So we are open for any Q&A if anybody wants for.
I work for one of the OEMs, so I'm right here.
Okay. Thank you.
I think a number of points have been raised by each one of you. Somebody spoke about emotional stress. Somebody spoke about high investments. Somebody spoke about the growth story, you know, and somebody's committed towards future growth as well. But out of all these factors, for each one of you, I want to know, what is the key driving force behind staying or leaving or asking your brood to join the business or not join the business? Is it a lifestyle issue? Is it a rational, thought out, financial problem that you foresee? Or is it just the fact that you don't want them to be so stressed when they run their businesses? So out of these three, what are the priority areas for each one of you?
So I feel this side of somebody.
Yeah, I'll answer. For me, I think that it's the risk versus the reward. My reward is not consumerate with the risk that I take on the business. And if it's consumerate, then I will ask them to join the business. And that, I think that's my thing, is risk versus reward is out of balance right now. Unless you are with one of the leading Activa, someone talked about I've grown Activa or Maruti. If you're not one of those brands, then the risk is far more than the reward.
Yeah, I think that's what even I pointed out, that if you're not with one of the top three manufacturers, then it's really difficult for you to make money out of this business. And it's really stressful. But what keeps me going is, you know, the thrills and the challenges that the auto industry brings forward. I think it's challenging because the manufacturer keeps you on your toes throughout. And, you know, market share is a prime objective for everyone. So it's thrilling and it's really challenging. So that's what keeps me going.
You represent the other side of the industry. So together we've always found means and ways to keep that business profitable and sustainable over a period of time. And I am optimistic that we'll keep doing so as partners. We're in the same boat together. So.
Good evening. And I would like to know that how would you suggest to motivate the next generation from the perception of a dealer?
So what I summarized, I'll ask you also to add. I had said we have an Automobile Dealer Association, which is Federation of Automobile Dealer Association, and ET Auto Nabil is working with us for that. So what we are doing, we are selecting some top 100 dealers of India and publishing their stories. So obviously, even me being in FADA and knowing them, the details what comes in, I was unaware. So I get some good points to take home and then improve. So obviously, till date, automobile dealership was a normal business which was trading. Nobody thought that an auto dealer can be such big, equivalent to an industry who is hiring 100, 200 people, and we are hiring 200 per dealership. So we have four dealerships, so we multiply. There is a statement which our president, Mr. John, always, John, are you busy somewhere? So Mr. John always says that the top three Maruti dealers employ more manpower than Maruti itself. So you can see the enormity of auto dealership. So what we are trying through FADA and ET Auto is create a good image about dealerships, so that at least the people who doesn't know about auto dealers much, they think of that, and the people who have negative thoughts, we are able to change something. That's it. So if anybody wants to join in, you're welcome.
Answering to your question, we need to leave our stress at work when we go home, and we need to talk positive things about the kind of work we are in. So even if you're a professional, you would go home to your family, you would want your family to be, look, to see you happy, for them to be happy. So that's what, on the personal front, we are, all of us are doing and all of us need to do. FADA, FADA and ET Auto, a great initiative, getting people together, sharing success stories. So everything adds up. A positivity is being created in the system. So once that positivity is created, the positivity starts spreading. And if we talk about the number of dealers, say if in India they were around 13,000-14,000 dealers across the industry last year, that number is growing every year. Probably not in double digits in terms of percentage, but in numbers. So that in itself implies the number of people taking to this trade. There are more people who are taking to this trade, and they are more people who still would want to come on board, who were not chosen by the principals to be their associates or their business partners. So people are still, that the dealership community is still growing. For it to grow, it implies that the next generation has already come on board, or us, we have started planning for some few years down the line wherein we see our next generation coming on board. We are expanding or growing our business for them. So that in itself rest the case whether people are still not pursuing automobile dealerships to add on to their business.
What I would do, I would motivate them, the children, to join the business, because I think overcoming challenges itself is a thrill. I don't think we are starved for food or something, and after the basics have been met, I think the challenges that the dealership business poses are good, and even in the industry may not be doing well. You know, my projection is not very good. But even in that, they have top 10% dealers who are doing extremely well. So I would try to motivate my children and say that please be in the top 10, overcome the challenge, give them the tools, their strategies, their plans. So I think it's going to be still a good business to do to be in the top 10%. That's how I would motivate the challenge and the overcoming the challenge as a factor to motivate them.
Thank you, everybody. That's it from our side. Thanks for listening, sir.